Hello everyone. This is my overview video of my 8-bit computer that I built this year after I watched the Ben Eater video series on YouTube. Those of you who haven't seen it yet should definitely watch it later. So after I saw this series, I was totally impressed how easy he explained all the functions that a computer has and how easy it seemed to implement it on a breadboard. So that meant no soldering required, no knowledge of higher electronics but the trivial basics, and all the things were just put together from logic chips, from TTL chips that are freely available on eBay or even on Amazon or Mouser or whatever provider you like to do. And it was so impressive that I thought I want to build something like this myself, and I started building that project about April, and I made some enhancements. So James Bates was the one who convinced me to do some more than just the basic things that Ben Eater did, and so I also implemented some extra parts. And in this video I'd like to show you what parts my 8-bit computer has and how they are related to Ben Eater's parts. The first part that I built was the clock, which sits on the upper right corner of the breadboard as it does in Ben Eater's build. And the major enhancement is the possibility to skip over a halt breakpoint by just pressing the single step button. Of course, it also has the feature of stepping one microcode instruction at a time and to resume normal operation as soon as you have finished debugging. The clock runs at a fixed speed of 1.8 megahertz. Ben Eater's computer has a 7-segment LED output display that I use primarily for debugging purposes, and I also implemented the feature to display the value as negative value in the range from -128 to 127 or as a hex value, and I added the feature to show the byte as a binary value so that the longer lines are ones and the shorter lines are zeros. My build has a 16-bit address bus, so I can address 64k bytes of memory, whereas most of the part is RAM. 64k is RAM explicitly, and there is a ROM chip which is 32k wide, but I only use 8k at a time, and I can switch which bank I want to use, and this decides whether I use the RAM or the ROM. And since the stack pointer line goes into that decision, the stack can reside in RAM where usually ROM is available. This is the way to check for memory during debugging. So when I want to see what is stored in a certain address, I can switch to manual memory mode and can choose the address to view, and can also change the bytes that are at that address. The program counter is 16-bit wide because I have 64k of RAM to address, and so I used 4 of those counter chips to store the program counter. And the program counter is directly connected to the memory module via that 16-bit address bus, but also has a connection to the data bus to output the current state of the program counter for subroutine calls or the like. Since the address bus is 16-bit wide while the data bus only has 8 bits, I added a register that allows two 8-bit data bytes to be seen as a single 16-bit address. And that register can be used either directly to access memory or can be used to transfer those 16-bit addresses to the program counter or to the stack pointer via the 16-bit address bus. The yellow LEDs show the state of the 16-bit stack pointer, which is stored in these four up-down counters, and the upper and lower bytes can be put on the data bus, but the main purpose of the register is to access memory via that 16-bit address bus to implement the stack for the system. My build has four general purpose registers. This register A, B, C, and D, and the data of the register is held in a single chip, and that chip is connected to the data bus via that bus transceiver. But the output of the chip is always enabled so that the LEDs are able to reflect the state of the register at all time. This is the ALU of my computer build, and those two LS183 chips are responsible for adding, subtracting and logical operations, and these multiplexes are used for shift operations, and the temporary result is shown with the yellow LEDs and then latched into that ALU register, and the ALU register is connected to the data bus with that bus receiver. And the flags are stored in a separate register chip, which is also connected to the bus with that bus transceiver. Some flags are calculated with those multiplexes or with this multi-NOR chips like the zero flag. The microcode of the control logic is stored in these four EEPROMs, which makes a total of 32 control lines. And the step counter for the microcode is 12-bit wide, so I used three counter chips. The output of that controller is shown with the blue LEDs on the top. And some of the output lines are multiplexed so that I can save some extra lines. And this fast flickering blue LED is the interrupt inhibit, so whenever that LED is lit there are no interrupts allowed. The red LEDs show the step counter state, and these two LEDs show the interrupt state. The instruction register is part of the instruction decoder module. After the instruction is fetched from the data bus, it will be translated to an address in the microcode modules with these two EEPROMs. And the address is fed forward to the microcode counter via these address lines. And there is also a reset button for the whole 8-bit computer that resets the microcode counters to zero. In addition to the base CPU, I added some external peripherals like this LCD display with this potentiometer for the contrast and this transistor for the backlight. And these two chips are to receive and send data with the LCD display, and this transceiver sends the data to the data bus. And these two cards are SPI bus cards. It's an SD card and a real-time clock. And these two can also connect to the data bus with this transceiver. And these two chips are the port logic, so these two chips decide which port is active. The last device is a PS2 keyboard controller that reads scan codes from the keyboard via a shift register, so that a scan code can be sent to the data bus. And as soon as the scan code is available, the clock of the keyboard will be inhibited so that no additional bytes will be sent from the keyboard. But this logic can also be used to send bytes to the keyboard and to adjust the LEDs of the keyboard. So I wrote a command line interface and some simple commands like list the directory of the SD card or find out how much space is free on that SD card. So this is done in 512 byte chunks. Or you can list the contents of a file on the SD card. And some write operations like removing a subdirectory on the SD card. And of course some mathematical things like calculating prime numbers. So this is just a simple algorithm. It's not that fast, but it does well, it does what it should do. Jump out of this. And of course every Van Eder inspired 8-bit computer should calculate Fibonacci numbers, and so does mine. I calculate all the 16-bit numbers. So it's not the prettiest solution, but it does what it shall do, and yeah, these are the correct numbers. But nothing is done if Tetris won't run, so I wrote a small Tetris clone, which is horizontal Tetris, so the parts will fly in from the right side and yeah, glide to the left side. So this concludes the demo of my Van Eder inspired 8-bit computer. I will put the link to my GitHub repository in the description below, so you can look for the schematics and some of the code that I used. I also plan on doing some more videos that go into depth for some of the modules. So feel free to comment, and yeah, maybe see you soon. Bye.